Luck I have, it will be. on audiobook format, which I find is, well, I'm a big fan of it. If you've seen, I'm sure you've heard me mention it if you've seen more than a couple of my episodes. The Story of Civilization is a massive, under 80 years in the works, where they tried to chronicle from ancient Mesopotamian to Greek, Egyptian, Roman, European, and eventually American history. And they tried to chronicle and make it into a narrative, a cohesive narrative structure. They tried to make a story out of civilization's history, called The Story of Civilization, naturally. Anyways, this is pretty much the epilogue or coda to that. So, that said, I want to, read you guys another essay. Hey, maybe I'll eventually get to book. This is a sequel so far. Follow-up to the Cycle of Civilizations essay, which, let's see, what was that? It was actually called, I think it was just called Government and History, but I thought Cycle of Civilizations was a more catchy title, because it did show a lot of modern parallels to ancient, well-recognized ancient cycles of government that I just happened to very, very easily be able to make an analog for the present day with this essay.
As insecurely as Peter walking on the waves.
Geography is the matrix of history, its nourishing mother and disciplining home. Its rivers, lakes, oases, and oceans draw settlers to their shores. For water is the life of organisms and towns. It offers inexpensive roads for transport and trade. Egypt was the gift of the Nile, and Mesopotamia built successive civilizations between the rivers and along their effluent canals. India was the daughter of the Indus, and Brahmaputra and the Ganges. China owed its life and sorrows to the great rivers that, like ourselves, often wandered from their proper beds and fertilized the neighborhood with their overflow. Italy adorned the valleys of the Tiber, the Orno, and the Po. Austria grew along the Danube, Germany along the Elbe and the Rhine, France along the Rhone, the Loire and the Seine. Petra and Palmyra were nourished by oases in the desert. When the Greeks grew too numerous for their boundaries, they found colonies along the Mediterranean, like frogs around a pond, said Plato, and along the Euxine, or Black Sea. For 2,000 years, from the Battle of Salamis around 480 BC, Spanish Armada in 1588, the northern and southern shores of the Mediterranean were the rival seats of the white man's ascendancy. But in and after 1493, the voyages of Columbus and Vasco da Gama invited men to brave the oceans. The sovereignty of the Mediterranean was challenged. Genoa, Pisa, Florence, Venice declined. The Renaissance began to fade. The Atlantic nations rose and finally spread their suzerainty over half the world. West westward the course of empire takes its way, wrote George Berkeley around 1730. Will it continue across the Pacific, exporting European and American industrial and commercial techniques to China, as formerly to Japan? Will Oriental fertility, working with the latest Occidental technology, bring the decline of the West? The development of the airplane will again alter the map of civilization. Trade routes will follow less and less the rivers and seas. Men and goods will be flown more and more directly to their goal. Countries like England, France, will lose their commercial advantage of abundant coastlines conveniently indented. Countries like Russia, China, and Brazil, which were hampered by the excess of their land over their coasts, will cancel part of that handicap by taking to the air. Coastal cities will derive less of their wealth from the clumsy business of transferred goods, from ship to train, and from train to ship. When sea power finally gives place to air power and transport and war, we shall have seen one of the basic revolutions in history. The influence of geographic factors diminishes as technology grows. The character and contour of a terrain may offer opportunities for agriculture, mining, or trade, but only the imagination and initiative of leaders and the hardy industry of followers can transform the possibility into fact, and only a similar combination as Israel today can make a culture take form over 1,000 natural obstacles. Man, not the earth, makes civilization. So that was basically, that was an introductory essay. And a nice little snippet of, a nice taste of their particular style of fusing or coalescing very, very articulate philosophy out of their very expansive understanding of knowledge of history. And they've kind of distilled what it is that keeps reoccurring and reoccurring, so they're able to predict the revolution that airplanes, in fact, have started having. Just read and are continuing to read is written in 1968, so remember that. Well before the internet. That was actually part A, chapter 2 right there. That wasn't even the introductory chapter or preface, whatever you might call it, prologue, foreword. I suppose that was the most broad just chapter one. I don't know why I keep insisting it's another name. It's called Hesitations, and I think I might be a little rash in skipping over this, so I think I'll read this. It's very short, relatively the same length as what we just read. And it's called Hesitations because I'm sure we'll get a much clearer idea if we just read the damn thing. But they're wise enough to know that they aren't establishing any lasting truths, or at least any objective truths. They're wise enough to know the temporariness of specific manifestations of civilization, and also wise enough to know some of the wisdom to be gleaned off of, even as transitory and fleeting and ephemeral as the great ER chose to make one half of his name. The characteristics of human beings, they chose to be able to be confident enough that they're doing a benefit by writing this book and sharing the lessons of history that they've learned without any pretenses of omnipotence. And by the way, speaking of ephemeral rift, I just saw his video called, maybe subconsciously it made me want to make this, called The Civilization Is a Cancer and Why We Should Live Outdoors. And I had a lot of counter arguments to those that he made in that video. So if I find enough time, I think I'll make a little open letter to ER. And with any luck, he probably won't have the time to sit down and start a dialogue with me, but I'd at least like to maybe shed, well, at least assert my opinion, and particularly on the things that he dismisses so readily about civilization, because he wants to essentially shirk civilization and live in small tribes. But yet he's very familially and communally focused, so I think he just hasn't. Anyways, now, I just had a lot of things I wanted to say, and a lot of points that I don't think are useful to really harbor as a core tenet of your outlook and perspective on the world. So I'd be curious to hear what he says, if he does, but if not, maybe I'll get some other good feedback from you guys or some of his followers. But I thought it was an interesting video nonetheless. He seems like a really sincere individual, and I think ironically the last thing I just wanted to say is that he is dwelling on his despair and depression about being his individuality being suppressed and his freedom being suppressed by the organized system of civilization. Yet, ironically, he's using that system, as someone pointed out in one of his videos, using a high-def camera and Nazis ranting against the very institutions that enabled the creation of such high-tech objects, and also perhaps you might say the leisure time that was available to him. So, I think what he delivers to the ASMR community is ironically of so much value, and he wouldn't be able to do that if he were living a primitive lifestyle. So that's just one of the biggest flaws I see in his logic. But anyways, I intend to make an entire episode, or just a response, maybe. So, hopefully start a nice, pleasant, open discourse about what he said. Let's begin. Hesitations, Chapter 1. As his studies come to a close, the historian faces the challenge. Of what use have your studies been? Have you found in your work only the amusement of recounting the rise and fall of nations and ideas and retelling sad stories of the death of kings? Have you learned more about human nature than the man in the street can learn without so much as opening a book? Have you derived from history any illumination of our present condition, any guidance for our judgments and policies, any guard against the rebuffs of surprise or the vicissitudes of change? Have you found such regularities in the sequence of past events that you can predict the future actions of mankind or the fate of states? Is it possible that, after all, history has no sense? That it teaches us nothing? And that the immense past was only the weary rehearsal of the mistakes that the future is destined to make on a larger stage and scale? At times we feel so, and a multitude of doubts assail our enterprise. To begin with, do we really know what the past was, what actually happened, or is history a fable not quite agreed upon? Our knowledge of any past event is always incomplete, probably inaccurate, beclouded by ambivalent evidence, biased historians, and perhaps distorted by our own patriotic and religious partisanship. Most history is guessing, and the rest is prejudice. That was a quote. Most history is guessing, and the rest is prejudice. It seems like there's quite a bit of truth in that. Even the historian who thinks to rise above partiality for his country, race, creed, or class betrays his secret predilection in his choice of materials and in the nuances of his adjectives. The historian always oversimplifies and hastily selects a manageable minority of facts and faces out of a crowd of souls and events whose multitudinous complexity he can never quite embrace or comprehend. Again, our conclusions from the past to the future are made more hazardous than ever by the acceleration of change. In 1909, Charles Bigeye thought that the world, quote, changed less since Jesus Christ than in the last 30 years, end quote. sometimes in war, every month. Some new invention, some method, or situation compels a fresh adjustment of behavior and ideas. Furthermore, an element of chance, perhaps of freedom, seems to enter into the conduct of metals and men. We are no longer confident that atoms, much less organisms, will respond in the future as we think they have responded. God move in mysterious ways. There are wonders to perform, and some quirk of character or circumstance may upset national equations, as when Alexander drank himself to death and let his new empire fall apart in 323 BC, or as when Frederick the Great was saved from a disaster by the accession of a Tsar infuriated with the Prussian ways in 1762. Obviously, historiography cannot be science. It can only be an industry, an art, a philosophy. An industry by ferreting out the facts. An art by establishing a meaningful order in the chaos of materials. A philosophy by seeking perspective and enlightenment. The present is the past rolled up for action, and the past is the present unrolled for understanding. Or so we believe and hope. In philosophy, we try to see the part in the light of the whole. In the, quote, philosophy of history, end quote, we try to see this moment in the light of the past. We know that, in both cases, this is a counsel for perfection. Total perspective is simply an optical illusion. We do not know the whole of man's history. There were probably many civilizations before the Sumerian or the Egyptian. We have just begun to dig. We must operate with partial knowledge and be provisionally content with probabilities. In history, as in science and politics, relativity rules. And all formulas should, in fact, be suspect. Quote, history smiles at all attempts to force its flow into theoretical patterns or logical grooves. It plays havoc with our generalizations, breaks all our rules, and history is baroque. End quote. Perhaps within these limits we can learn enough from history to bear reality patiently and to respect one another's delusions. Since man is a moment in astronomic time, a transient guest of the Earth, a spore of his species, a scion of his race, a composite of body, character, and mind, a member of a family and a community, a believer or doubter of a faith, a unit in an economy, perhaps a citizen in a state or a soldier in an army, we may ask under the corresponding heads, astronomy, geology, geography, biology, ethnology, psychology, morality, religion, economics, politics, and war, what history has to say about the nature, conduct, and prospects of man. It's a precarious enterprise, and only a fool would try to compress 100 centuries into 100 pages of hazardous conclusions. got from that is that he wants to make a point to say that all we have are specific examples, and more than likely, and he's probably learned by studying previous attempts at theorizing a generalization, a general pattern, a recognizable pattern in history, that those are extremely, extremely difficult. And being arrogant, being far too arrogant, you're most likely going to fail. So perhaps he's, if anything, he's learned something about human nature. Still out of all this, all his studies, I think it's that everybody has a unique perspective, and perhaps within these limits, as he said, we can learn enough from history to bear reality patiently and to respect one another's delusions. Another foray into the lessons of history by Will.